MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about hypertension guidelines and specifically the new guidelines that just came out in November of 2017 in comparison to the JNC7 guidelines that are now 14 years old. They came out in 2003. So let's get started. So the first thing that I want to do is I want to give you a sense about what's happened between these two periods of time. And to do that, I'm going to split the screen into two areas. And on the left, we're going to have JNC7. And now we're going to have the 2017 guidelines here on the right. I want to kind of break this up into the systolic blood pressure just for clarity. So here at the bottom, we're going to have 120. And then as we move up, we'll have 130. And then even as high as 160. Now, I'll add the diastolic numbers in a moment, but I think the guidelines are easier to remember initially with just the systolic numbers. In JNC7, they said that anybody less than 120 was going to be okay in terms of systolic blood pressure, and that was considered to be normal. When they hit 120 all the way up to 140, that was considered to be what they called, it was kind of a weird term, but they called it pre-hypertension. And this was supposed to be a yellow light, kind of like a traffic light, that occurred here at 140. And this was supposed to give pause to people who had blood pressures between 120 and 140. And then they went out full and said, okay, you have hypertension stage one if you're between 140 systolic and 160 systolic. So this was definitely red light area here, and that was known as stage one. And then things got really bad up here if you were above 160, and that they called stage two. So the thing about JNC7 was that you had this normal range, which is where they knew you had to be to make sure that you didn't have an increased probability of having morbidity from hypertension like stroke or coronary artery disease. And then there was this kind of gray zone where it was pre-hypertension, and they recommended kind of diet lifestyle changes and things to try to get that down because they knew there was an increased risk. But they really didn't call hypertension hypertension until you hit this magic number of 140. And I'll put here in small 140 over 90 because that was the key area. So what's with the new guidelines? Well, the new guidelines also agree, and they've kept it this way, that less than 120 is normal. No question about it. However, for the first time, they've gotten rid of pre-hypertension. Instead of pre-hypertension, they still have this yellow zone here, but they're calling it elevated. So between 120 and 130 now, whereas before that was pre-hypertension, they're now calling it elevated blood pressure. Now, between 130 and 140, they're now saying you have high blood pressure, and they're calling that stage one. Basically, anything above that is stage two. So you can see very clearly here that they've condensed the strata and made them lower, which means that for any given blood pressure, you're going to see that people are going to be ruling in for hypertensive disease. Still, 120 is the cutoff, but you can see for people, for instance, in this range, this 130 to 140, whereas before they had pre-hypertension, now they're going to be having hypertension. So this is the new standard here. It's the 130, and I'll put here in small, in terms of diastolic, this is really 130 over 80. So anything more than 130 over 80. So the 140 over 90 is out. The new blood pressure is the 130 over 80. However, this range between 140 and 130, they're not recommending medications or pharmacology here right off the bat. What they're recommending it for is a subsection of these people who are between 130 and 140. And who are they recommending it for? They're recommending it for people who already have coronary artery disease. And if you think about it, these people with coronary artery disease should already be on medications anyway. But then the other people are those with at least a 10% risk of coronary artery disease if they don't already have it. So what they're trying to do here is they're trying to institute medications earlier in select people. And the other thing that they're really trying to do is they're trying to take these people who were pre-hypertension before and it had a connotation that you're not quite there yet. And they're telling them, no, you're elevated. You have elevated blood pressure And we're hoping here that you're going to start thinking about diet and lifestyle, which is really where they're trying to push this, is instituting diet and lifestyle early. So they have some interesting things to say about that, because some studies have come out since 2003 about that particular thing. They had some recommendations as well. And actually, they came with the actual reduction in blood pressure that could be associated with each of these reductions. So they said that there was about a 4 to 5 millimeter of mercury, and that may sound small, but you have to remember that any particular drug is anywhere from 7 to 10. So this is not that weak in terms of its effect, but if you wanted a 4 to 5 millimeter reduction in blood pressure, you gotta do a low sodium diet, increase dietary intake of potassium, exercise, and limit alcohol intake for a man less than 2, and for a woman less than or equal to 1 drink. But at the same time, what they found was that if you wanted to have an 11 millimeter of mercury drop, decreased sodium intake, decreased saturated fats, increased fruits and vegetables, and increased grains. They had the same recommendations that they've had in the past regarding the 4 different categories of medications: the ACE-ARB, the beta blocker, the calcium channel blocker, and the diuretics. They said that all of these are first-line agents to use except the beta blocker. So not a first-line agent. Of course, beta blockers would be great if the patient has concomitant coronary artery disease. Again, as they've said in the past, that you should not use ACE and ARBs together. That wouldn't be good. To watch out for them if there is increased potassium, because all of these increase potassium, so you want to be careful of that. They also said that in African Americans, you want to use the calcium channel blocker or the diuretics. They seem to work better in African Americans, and this is what they've said in the past. In terms of diuretics, even though a lot of people use hydrochlorothiazide, the actual studies have been with chlorothalidone. It's once daily. There is some evidence that it actually is more efficacious. And again, they're recommending chlorothalidone. Unless, of course, the GFR is less than 30, in which case thiazide diuretics don't work very well when the GFR is 30, then you switch to Lasix. And Lasix is also a good option for patients with low ejection fraction from heart failure. Preoperative issues they've talked about before. You don't really want to stop a beta blocker if a patient's going into an operation. So the recommendations haven't changed much in terms of the medications that are taken. And if you want more information on all of those types of medications and more, make sure you watch our video on hypertension. But what's really changed is the classification. And this will result in about 46 to 47% of adults in the United States as having hypertension, which means that they would have a blood pressure that is elevated or greater than 120. And that's a pretty significant portion of people in the United States to be deemed as having elevated blood pressure. But again, this is under the guise of getting on things more early and treating that. There are explanations out there for these new guidelines, and I'd encourage you to look those up. Thanks for joining us.